Thank you, Lindsay. And thanks to all of you very much for attending. As Lindsay mentioned, my name is Carl Minzer, Senior Fellow for China Studies here at the Council on Foreign Relations. And this is the fourth of my Politics and Society in East Asia Roundtable series. And I'm delighted to have with me today a man who needs no introduction, Professor Jerry Cohen. Before we begin, I'll just remind everyone of the ground rules. This is a little bit different from our usual roundtables at the CFR. Usually our events are off the record and not for attribution. However, this one is not only on the record, it'll actually be taped and be placed on YouTube because it's a historic document looking back at Jerry and 50 years of work on China. Our format's going to still parallel what we have both for in-person events. First 45 minutes will be me engaging with Jerry and a little bit of back and forth over his five decades of work on China. And the second 45 minutes, we will take questions from the audience. And when you're called on, Lindsay will unmute you so that you can talk. We'll keep a queue and then we'll have the questions and answers at the end. Professor, one other note is there are some technical issues. There's high wind up at Cape Cod where Jerry Cohen is currently located. And so there's a possibility that we may lose the connection. If so, he's going to try to call back in on the phone, but there could potentially be some interconnection problems. I'll just flag that for folks. We've got backup systems in place. So cross our fingers, we don't need to use them. Professor Jerry Cohen himself needs no introduction. He's one of the key figures in the development of the field of Chinese law in the United States and worldwide. From his starting, of course, with his early studies in the 1960s, to his first visit in China 50 years ago, actually 50 years ago right today, or as of May 20th, in 1972, to practicing law in China in the 1980s, to three decades of work at NYU, Jerry has been deeply involved in Chinese law as well as in all matter of exchanges between the United States and China. This offers us an opportunity to look back at five decades of legal developments in China, as well as U.S.-Chinese exchanges centered on legal issues. And so I thought, just as an opening, perhaps, you know, we could take note that this is, in fact, if I've got my dates correct, this is the 50th anniversary of your first visit to China. I believe you arrived on May 20th, 1972, for the first time ever, as part of a delegation with the Federation of American Scientists. Can you just tell us a little bit about how that happened? Give us the background of how that event came about, what it was like, why they were interested in you. Tell us the story.
Can you hear me, Carl?
Yes, I can.
Wonderful. You know, we say five decades, but actually I had waited 12 years for this opportunity to go to China. I began August 15th, 1960 at 9 a.m. to study Chinese language. I was making a big bet. And after a short time, I began to get impatient. I wrote letters to Chairman Mao and Zhou Enlai asking to go to China. They were so busy arguing with the Soviet Union and Khrushchev that they never answered me. I did hear from an American communist, Dorothy Fisher, who was in Beijing. She had heard a Hands Across the Sea, Voice of America interview that had been done with me asking the same question you asked, why did we study Chinese law? And she wrote me and asked me, why don't I come over to China? And I wrote back saying, well, you know, there are only two obstacles. One is the US government, one is the Chinese government. I said, I'll work on the US, you work on China. I never heard from her again. So there was a series of frustrations. And of course, we then went through the beginning of the Cultural Revolution, conditions until 1971 September, I'd say, were hardly optimal for a visit, but things began to warm up. I then tried in 71 about seven different ways to get into China. And the one that came through first was the one you mentioned, the Federation of American Scientists. I had been asked, would I serve as their China advisor if they got a chance to go. And they did get an early chance because Marvin Goldberger, we called him Murph, a famous scientist, he had been the president's science advisor. The Chinese thought he knew about the soft bomb that was being developed for Vietnam. And so the Federation of American Scientists got invited before a lot of more obvious groups, and they didn't know anything about China. And I was asked to go along as the third member of the group. And to make the invitation more tempting, they said we could invite our spouses. So that made a wonderful opportunity for Joan, who had been spending 12 years preparing to study contemporary Chinese art. And off we went, as you say, May 20th is the right date. At that time, I had been working on China a long time. Many people, when I made the decision in 1960 to study China, thought I must be having a nervous breakdown. Why would anyone throw away a promising career on American public law to study a country we had no contact with? We had very bad feelings toward China. We couldn't go there. They couldn't come here. The Korean War's impact was still being felt. And a lot of people asked why I was doing this. By 72, it was becoming clear that China was emerging gradually from the Cultural Revolution. It was hardly over. And that China was trying to enter the world community. Indeed, by May 72, China had already been in the UN, taking the seat of China from the Chiang Kai-shek regime in October 71. So all of a sudden, we had a real world to deal with. But the problem was access. In the absence of formal diplomatic relations between the United States and China. Can you hear me, Carl?
Yes, I can. Something has gone off my electricity. Let me see here if I can.
Oh, sorry. In any event, by 72, many American China specialists were eager for access. We had to wait until the famous Nixon trip to Beijing in February 72. And after that, gradually and selectively, the gates to actually visit the People's Republic began to open. And we were invited by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to spend a month at their invitation, and they paid the local costs within China. So it was a great opportunity and with many highlights. And Joan and I had different impressions of China. She saw it more clearly in terms of the repression of the artists, et cetera. I was excited because of the opportunity to learn about the bureaucracy and get some insight into the shreds of what remained of their then legal system.
What were your when you were showed up in 1972? What were your goals for the visit? Like, what were you mentally thinking was possible in the field of? Were you seeing this as the opening of China and yourself going on to, you know, rise up in? What did you just perceive as possible at that moment?
The world looked new and shiny, and it was an opportunity to learn. I was excited about getting to meet Chinese people on the scene. I had been interviewing refugees from China over time. I'd done a great amount of work in preparation, but I didn't know what we'd find. I looked for the obstacles that they would obviously present to learning. I looked for the opportunity. We wanted to meet Zhou Enlai, because I wanted to talk about international relations as well as China's domestic legal system. And I had a specific mission from my college classmates. I was in the class of 51 at Yale College. We had a classmate, Jack Downey, who had been shot down over China in November 52, about 16 months after graduation. He was still in Chinese prison after 20 years. And my class had designated me as the person to try to get him out. And I'd been working on that in various respects. And I hoped during my visit, I would have a chance to push that specific proposition, as well as talk about how to extract the US from the Vietnam War, how to deal with China and international law, participation in the UN. And above all, did they have any plans for the legal system, the Soviet-style legal system that they had established in the 50s and then had been demolished by the anti-rightist movement of 57, 58, the Great Leap Forward, and then the Cultural Revolution. And so there were a lot of things on the agenda. Joan was hoping to meet Chinese artists, learn something about what were they doing, what did they know about the West. And we were, you know, our agenda was huge. We were open-minded and we just wanted to take advantage of whatever opportunity was presented.
And what did you feel was the reaction? Like, what did you feel on the Chinese side in terms of whether there was interest and what, you know, why were they interested in you? What could you sense, like, you know, we were taking the step just a couple months after Nixon's visit to invite you as well as the other people on the delegation. What were you sensing from them?
They were trying, the members of the delegation, to establish relations with the Chinese Academy of Sciences. The American Academy of Sciences, the US government-sponsored, more general group, they were not having huge success. The Federation took more advanced political views, and their specific goal, could we invite the Chinese successfully to come to the United States for the first tour of Chinese scientists so we could begin exchanges? And we succeeded in that goal, of course. And that made for some interesting visits to various cities in the United States, starting with Boston and Harvard University. So, but we were interested, of course, more broadly. John Fairbank, who came to the dinner that Joe and Lai gave in his honor, in which I sort of crashed with the aid of one of Joe and Lai's assistants, our goal was to try to get Chinese to be sent to Harvard to begin to be visiting scholars, to be students, perhaps visiting professors or lecturers. And we knew that Joe would resist that in the absence of formal diplomatic relations. And John and I spent a good part of the time we were having dinner with Joe trying to persuade him to go, let people go to Harvard. And I remember when we took a men's room break, as we stood at our respective urinals, John was a little embarrassed how much pressure he was putting on. And he said to me with mock sincerity, "The missionary spirit dies hard." And of course, that's what we were. We were missionaries for exchanges, academic freedom. I was interested, of course, in the law school exchanges, and Joe and I kept shooting us down with the arguments why they had to wait until formal relations were established. His view was, if we send PRC people to Harvard, they might be asked for a debate or discussion. Maybe there'd be somebody from Taiwan on the stage. Wouldn't that be a recognition of two Chinas? We can't allow that. I said that was a rather extreme interpretation and we could deal with that problem. But they were determined, they wanted formal diplomatic relations. And that took almost 7 years more, as you know.
And you said missionary. I mean, you brought the mission, you're saying it jokingly, but did you really see yourselves as, you know, Jonathan Spence's book, To Change China? Did you see that this was, you know, where we are going to be part of a process by which China is changed through academic exchanges, through students going overseas? Did you see, you know, the building of a legal system? Did you conceive of your engagement in that way? Or were you thinking of it like more short term? And you just, this is an interesting place that we want to learn more about.
I always like what Alexander Pope, the poet, said. Hope springs eternal in the human breast. Man never is, but always to be blessed. We didn't know. We didn't feel we were missionaries. I certainly didn't, but I was interested. I didn't know to what extent the Chinese would be interested. I wanted to learn. Until that trip, I'd had to rely on the usual kinds of sources. Anything published, there were very few things about law in the legislative books. There were very few reports about cases except in the newspapers, most of them about criminal law. There was very little information. You had to piece together scraps. I then, as you know, did a long year of interviews in Hong Kong with 63-4, but we went with open minds trying to see what was China interested in. We could hardly be naive after the anti-rightist movement in 57-58 that abolished the Soviet-style legal system. After the Great Leap Forward pretty much demolished any serious legal efforts. And then the Cultural Revolution certainly finished that job. You couldn't be naively hopeful that all of a sudden the Chinese communists were going to turn around and be rule of law seeking people. On the other hand, we knew they were practical and they were trying under Zhou's guidance to reach out to the world, improve the very bad impression that events in China had left on the world. And they knew that the law was one of the relevant points that people look to. And Zhou Enlai, with a sly grin, he said to me, "I understand you've done many books about our legal system." And the way his eyes flicked sort of suggested he thought maybe I had made more about the legal system in China than China had. So I don't think either side was naive, but this was sort of an exploratory 30-day effort. They were also very anxious in the spring of 72 about the forthcoming re-election campaign of President Nixon. They were worried that George McGovern, the Democratic senator, might win. And McGovern had been calling for reducing the American defense platform by one third. And that was the last thing China wanted. They wanted our support vigorously against the Soviet Union. So they were frightened McGovern had a chance. I was an advisor to McGovern on China for my sins. And I assured the Chinese that he had no chance of winning against Nixon, especially after China had helped re-elect him by giving him the spectacular February 21st to 28th, 72 visit to China, because that was his leading card for accomplishment and re-election.
So let's fast forward a little bit to the sort of the late 70s, because this is where, you know, as you mentioned, when you first meet Zhou Enlai, he's a little bit skeptical of why are you interested in Chinese law. Did you sense a shift in 1978? Did you, you know, what changes, you know, several years later, do you begin to see a sense of different tone emanating from China as the reform period begins to launch in?
Throughout the 70s in the UN and in their relations that were developing gradually with the Western power, China saw the importance of international law, and they also saw they were poorly equipped to meet the immediate challenge. I remember Huang Hua, ambassador then to the UN, telling me how pathetic it was. China had to send somebody to the UN Sixth Committee, the legal committee. He said, I had no one on my staff to send. So I sent my wife, who was an economist, and she doesn't know anything about international law. And that was the situation in 71, 2, 3. So China knew on international law, they had to do something. They had to revive the people they put on the shelf 16, 17 years, who were experts in international law, and they had to train a new foreign policy bureaucracy of diplomats who were sophisticated. But as far as domestic law goes, there was no real push for China to learn something about international or domestic law until December 78. Then at the classic party plenum, where Zhou Enlai he had already passed on in January 76, was replaced as the leader of China by Deng Xiaoping. And in December 78, Deng, having accomplished finally his ascendancy or reascendancy, he came out in favor of a formal domestic legal system. And at that point, Chinese became interested in what kind of a legal system. Should it be just a reiteration of the Soviet system they had first imported in the 50s? Should it be a Western style system? Should it be some kind of agglomeration of melding of Soviet and Western? And what about Chinese legal tradition? And to what extent should they inherit consciously the legal system that was quite sophisticated, even though often ignored by Chiang Kai-shek, the preceding pre-49 regime in China? So they had many questions, and that's what made visiting China in 1979 particularly fascinating.
Because you sensed that there was sort of a deep interest on the part of your Chinese interlocutors for knowing more.
There was no doubt about it. I was invited in February 79 by the Ministry of Finance, a National Tax Bureau, to come and talk about what kind of tax legislation China needed, because they wanted American oil companies to invest offshore China. American oil companies would not do so if they couldn't subtract from every dollar they paid to U.S. income tax expenditures in China. So they had to have a tax system set up that the U.S. Treasury and the U.S. tax people would find creditable, so oil companies could credit against their American income tax all their expenditures looking for oil offshore China. Then I was invited the next month by the Chinese Council for the Promotion of International Trade to come and talk about joint ventures, foreign investment. Deng Xiaoping wanted to use law as an instrument of economic development to develop the domestic economy as well as international trade and investment. And I was invited to come and set up lectures for a week about joint ventures because they wanted immediate foreign investment and they didn't know what a joint venture was. So from then on, all spring, I would be getting invited by the city of Beijing, the city of Tianjin, Guangzhou, particularly Shanghai. And then I decided visiting every few weeks from Hong Kong, where we were then spending my Harvard sabbatical, was not satisfactory. I wanted to live in China, because living there is very different from just being short-term visitors. And then luckily we made a connection to the city of Beijing, and they invited me to come and spend a year teaching not students in the law schools. They wouldn't let me go near the law schools, and the law schools hadn't revived much at that point. but they wanted me to train their bureaucrats. Their people were beginning to negotiate with major U.S. companies. I'll never forget a very smart young man from Shanghai who wanted to go to Harvard Law School. And I said, why do you want to study law? He said, I work in the law and contract division of the Ministry of First Industries. And we in the law and contract division every day are negotiating with Volkswagen about a joint venture. And we in the law and contract division have only one problem. I said, what's that? He said, we don't know anything about law or contracts. That was the situation in 1979. And they asked me to come and train cadre, people actively involved in negotiating with foreigners in not human rights law, in Western constitutional law, not in public international law, but they wanted to know about contracts.
So did you have the sense that this was all, I mean, you are in the sort of 79, 80, you are engaged. Is there a sense that this is somehow wrapped up in broader legal trends? I mean, while you are engaged in the commercial, do you see that this is part of a broader shift, or do you view that at that point as just, it's only, they only want you for the contract for the international business? Did you sense that this was part of a broader trajectory in society?
They were a mixed group.
Right.
Some of them just wanted to meet everyday contract challenges, right, and negotiations. Some wanted to use this as an instrument for developing better institutions. And some wanted even to develop a revived legal profession, because they saw without a profession of lawyers, China wouldn't be able to cope with all the needs of international and domestic development. So different people had different motives, different ministries. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs wanted to train people for their legal division. And they asked me to arrange for their leading interpreter, a very smart young woman, to go to Harvard Law School. And they wanted another very bright Chinese law graduate to go abroad to Harvard, if possible, in order to get a master's degree. They wanted the woman from the foreign ministry to stay 3 years and get a regular American legal education. And that was very ambitious. But different groups, like the Ministry of Foreign Trade, they had their own needs. Foreign trade corporations wanted to have people who understood international business law. And I remember arranging for a Harvard fellowship for a very smart fellow from one of the foreign trade corporations. So each group had a different view. We were not allowed at that point to learn the needs of the law schools. The law schools were still too sensitive. And I had very limited contact during the 2 years, 79 to 81, 2.5 years really, that I spent in China with law professors, unless they were involved in business advisory capacity. But the economic and political groups, they were very eager to learn about law.
So, I mean, of course, the 1980s is the period where you're practicing law in China. After 1990, you make a shift to sort of leave China to come to, well, to work at NYU, and that's after Tiananmen Square. What did you think was possible at that point? You know, this is a very different, this is, China has now taken a, you know, killed, had the crackdown in Tiananmen Square. You had, you know, it looks like political change is, you know, off the table. What did you sense in the 90s when you're beginning to sort of build the US ALI program at NYU and engage in interactions with Chinese law professors in a very different environment? What were you seeing? What were you thinking was possible in the 90s?
By June 4th, 1989, we had begun to train a number of very good specialists on law in China. I didn't feel I was alone anymore. We had a number of good practicing lawyers, some of them Chinese, and we had a number of young law teachers. And I felt I had to shift my priorities. June 4th made a very profound, depressing impression. I felt we'd done something, or I had taken part in some efforts to promote the law as an instrument of economic development. I hadn't done enough in terms of the human rights protections of individuals, criminal justice reform, et cetera. As you know, that was what I started with in China. I had started life in Washington, 1955 to 59, as a law clerk in the courts. And then I was an assistant US attorney. I did criminal prosecutions. I tried jury cases. And then I worked finally for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Senator Fulbright, for about 4 months trying to get legal reforms to improve our relations generally with the world. I hadn't discovered China yet. And then when human rights became so prominent after the disastrous massacre of June 4th, 89, I decided I better shift my priorities and go back to my original China field of the 60s, which was criminal justice. And that's what I decided to do. I began the soft pedal by law practice in the 90s, and I began to express myself more freely than I had during the period when I was trying to build a law practice. Because when you build a law practice, you have the future of 15 or 20 other lawyers involved. And I always felt under certain restraints that I didn't enjoy being an academic. And so beginning 1990, I had the chance to go to NYU, and eventually we established the US Asia Law Institute, similar to what I had done at Harvard with the East Asian Legal Studies program. And so in the last 30 odd years, I've been focused more on criminal justice, human rights, not ignoring China's legal progress in other areas of civil law, commercial law, of course, paying attention to international public law, especially when it impinged on issues like people getting locked up illegally in China. So I think—
And for about 20 odd years, 20 odd years, it's not only been, you know, academic exchanges, but you have been deeply involved with working with public interest lawyers in China. You've been involved in representing people who, you know, Zhao Yan, you know, New York Times journalists and others who themselves have fallen on, you know, been arrested or detained by Chinese authorities. And so, you know, you actually study, but also practice and work on these issues. Can I get you to sort of, what do you see right now? What's your, you know, having now 5 decades later, what's your evaluation of where China is right now?
Well, if you mean with respect to criminal justice and the legal system, this is, of course, a very dark time. On the one hand, China has done a great deal to enact legislation to set up a court system. To begin to publish millions of court decisions. As you know, you have a legal profession, a very large number. You have hundreds of thousands of people taking the bar exam. You have a lot of formal progress. And yet, in practice, we have to varying degrees in various fields, important departures from that practice. And I focused a lot on any kind of sanctions people would suffer that would be embraced under a comprehensive view of what is criminal justice. In other words, not just cases that are denominated criminal, the cases that are called administrative, like re-education through labor, anything that deprives people of their freedom, freedom to speak, freedom of the person, freedom to move, etc. And of course, I've been interested in other matters for years. I served as an arbitrator in commercial matters because that was the closest I could get as a foreign lawyer to the Chinese legal system. I took part in many arbitration cases in China under the auspices of Chinese institutions, as well as arbitrations conducted by foreign and international tribunals.
Is China today kind of rolling back? I mean, how far back has China gone? Under Xi Jinping, you've seen 5 decades of China, how far back a step is there? Is this sort of a reversal of 20 years? Is this a reversal? Where is China in terms of this long process that you have observed and worked on? How far back has China gone?
You're the expert on Xi Jinping and policy. Your book was a first-class treatment, and what you've written about changes in the legal system has been fundamental, Carl. But my own view is China is as repressive, efficiently repressive, as it's ever been. Certainly, some people say Xi Jinping is emulating Mao, but Mao, in the end, ran a different system. Xi Jinping would never tolerate the chaos that Mao created in various periods, etc. But of course, he does believe in absolute party control and party using the government as an instrument of repression. But this is not going to last. During the Cultural Revolution, when I published my criminal process book, 68, I wrote that things were bad then in the Cultural Revolution, of course. But I said, this too will pass. And of course, I said there would be a reaction against the excesses of the Mao regime. And there certainly was. That's what Deng represented. But then there was the struggle of the 80s. How should the party respond? And then after the massacre of June 4th, the people who believed in maximum repression, Li Peng and Deng Xiaoping himself, prevailed. And they have pretty much prevailed since June 4th, 1989. The struggle continues. The Xi Jinping regime now will also pass. I won't live to see it, but you will. And there will be a further attempt to improve the legal system in various ways if the US and China don't go to war over Taiwan.
I'm glad to get the optimistic look from somebody who's been working on the subject for 5 decades. That's really, I sometimes find myself doubting where will things go. One last question I want to ask before I turn it over to everybody, to the audience. You were part of a generation, if we think that China, I'm hoping that you're right, that there's a dark period, the walls close up, but then at some point you can imagine a brighter future. But there's still, that does mean that there will be an extended period of time of darkness, low contact, difficult understanding what's happening in China. That was what you experienced from 1960 to 1972. You were part of that generation who tried to study, to learn, to discuss about, understand China from a distance. You were trying to interview refugees in Hong Kong. You were deciphering newspaper columns overseas. And I think I found a quote from you. You said it was a little bit like researching Imperial Roman law or deciphering developments on the moon. it feels like we're kind of heading back to those days. Journalists being thrown out, academic links, severing or going dead, more political scrutiny of our Chinese colleagues, Chinese student flows overseas starting to, dry up somewhat. What kind of advice would you have for people today, like based on your earlier experience? What kind of advice would you have for academics or for journalists or diplomats about how we should understand and think about China and how we should try to build, or what should we do during this dark period that may be coming?
We first of all have to stop the process of decoupling. We have to continue to magnify our contacts and exchanges with China in every field. We must not allow separation of all the intellectuals in China and the professionals and the business people from the US or Western Europe or Japan and the rest of the world. So we have to work at that in every field. The night before last, our youngest son, Ethan Cohen, did a wonderful broadcast. He gave a lecture to the Chinese Academy of Art in Hangzhou. Well over 100 people attended. It was extremely difficult to get permission to do that, but the persistent people heading that institution made possible his lecture. And I hadn't even thought at that point of the problems of maintaining or strengthening contacts in the art field. And this is just the latest example. I'm proud of the fact our US Asia Law Institute at NYU, despite all the political problems, has continued to have very significant contacts and exchanges, and even some training with visiting scholars still coming, and some cooperation on matters of mutual interest. Despite what I said about the repressive Chinese regime, it's not in their interest, they often realize, to have wrongful convictions, to be exposed to their own public for having put to death someone who did not commit the crime for which the person was convicted, to take the most dramatic example. And we have continued to have various exchanges and contacts, and Zoom has been essential to that, even though the Chinese government often will interfere with some Zoom programs, et cetera, and refuse to grant permission for many of the cooperative programs we're suggesting. In every field, we have to keep up these contacts and develop them to the extent possible. There are some quiet developments going on that are usually not even understood or known to be taking place. The Washington lawyer, Dan Gutman, has done some remarkable things in Tianjin as well as Shanghai in quietly developing cooperation, again, on areas of mutual interest like the environment. When you talk about health problems, the environment, climate control, these are things we have to go on working on. And right now our officials are getting nowhere with China, because at the official diplomatic level, the PRC position is, don't talk to us about cooperating on climate or public health or any other important matters if you aren't cooperating with us politically. And yet how can we cooperate with them politically when they're committing horrible atrocities in areas not only in Xinjiang and Tibet, and now in the takeover of Hong Kong, but throughout the country in their repression of human rights lawyers, et cetera. And then China has many, you might say, aggressive tendencies in the world, like the South China Sea, the East China Sea. And of course, we have our own extensive, you might say, international ambitions. So the Chinese are saying to us, they don't want to cooperate on some things if we won't cooperate on others. And yet it's impossible for us to acquiesce in their demands on some of the issues. And Taiwan is the major one, of course, that we have differences of opinion. For a while, I had a policy I called the four C's, not S-E-A-S, but capital C's. And that called for, of course, cooperation, it called for competition, and it called for criticism, because I think mutual criticism in the public arena as well as private is valuable. If the Chinese give sincere criticism of America's many human rights failings, I think that's useful, even though not everyone would agree with me on that.
But also,
we also have, in addition, the final C would be not confrontation, but containment, because I do think we have to arrive at a certain point where we make it clear with China that we will not allow their absolute expansion throughout Asia. So it's very, very complicated. Law has a role in all these things. I'd like to see cooperation in all of them. I think we can continue, certainly in some legal fields, intellectual property, kind of work Mark Cohen at Berkeley does, for example, very, very important. And we have to build where we can. Criminal justice seems to be the least likely place we can build. But still, I think some of us have to devote our careers to highlighting those problems and the problems of a free legal profession in China.
So I want to just make sure to turn it over now. I'll begin. Those of you who would like to ask questions, feel free to use the raise hand button, and we can have our, please introduce yourselves when you ask your question, and I will ask, let's see, we'll go at it just in order that people are raising their hands. And I believe, Lindsay, we can start with Guchun and then go, yeah. Lindsay, can you do the unmuting?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, so my name is Guchun. I'm working at Durham University. Thank you very much, Jerry, for sharing your precious experiences. And my question, since you related to, referred to Taiwan, and we all know that one of your famous students is used to be the former president of Taiwan. So my question related to also to one of my my own experiences when I was learning or studying international law back in Germany. Then a professor of public international law asked me, do you know what the capital of Taiwan is? And I answered without hesitation, it was Taipei. He said, wrong, it's Nanjing. Theoretically, yes. And that was perhaps one of the hopes of many Chinese citizens in those days when I was still there. So my question is, would your missionary spirit or optimism lead you to believe that a third constitutional order would ultimately emerge? Combining Taiwan and the mainland? And if yes, I suppose your answer might be yes. If yes, which legal system or constitutional order would prevail? Is it the Republican one, the first Chinese Republic, or the second one, the Communist Republic?
It's a question, of course, that invokes the entire future. And I would say, I don't believe there's any realistic chance in the foreseeable decades that efforts for Taiwan and the mainland to join in some kind of constitutional framework that would allow the Taiwan people the degree of freedom that they now enjoy. All I think we can hope for is that we don't let the current situation get out of hand, that we allow developments to continue in Taiwan as they have very encouragingly done in the last couple of decades or more, and that we hope that the mainland will develop a more liberal regime, whether under the Communist Party or under some successor government, even military. But I don't see any blending of the two systems. Ma Ying-jeou was a good candidate. He did remarkable things. He made over 20 agreements on an Taiwan, even though China had always said, the PRC China, they would never make equal agreements with that mere province of Taiwan. But Ma, drawing on Chinese flexibility on both sides of the water, helped develop a formula that produced many beneficial developments for both sides. And I feel very sad, as many do, that although President Tsai, the successor to Ma, under the DPP party, different from the KMT of Ma, has tried to maintain those benefits without giving up forever the option that Taiwan might be independent of the mainland. I'm sorry that she has not been able to carry on all the agreements that Ma has succeeded in making and implementing some of the agreements that never quite got off the ground. But I think all these imaginative efforts to say we could have a third system of broader, greater China constitutional arrangement, I don't think that's on the cards. And I think given the mainland's record to date, although nothing is impossible, anything could happen if we take a long enough perspective, I think it's very unlikely that Taiwan would want to get involved in any arrangements. Just look at what happened in Hong Kong under one country, two systems, and the 1984 agreement between the UK and the PRC about a high degree of autonomy for Hong Kong. That kind of autonomy is enjoyed by Tibetans and people in Xinjiang. It's not the kind of autonomy that people in Taiwan would gamble for.
Okay, next I'll take James.
James, I'm a member of your SAFER Roundtable on China and the Rule of Law in New York City. So I'm just curious, just a quick question or two. So you suggested that this current period of a severe Chinese political repression under Xi Jinping will pass, but you didn't really tell us why you think that this current dark period will pass. What is the basis for your optimism? And my second question is really having to do with China and the rules-based international order. So do you think that over the past 50 years, China has in any way, you know, increased its respect for the rule of law and the rules-based international order, or over 50 years, China has been trying to subvert this order? I mean, where do you see China going in the future in terms of its respect for the rule of law and the rules-based international order?
Good questions, James. One concerning domestic law, one preeminently international. On the domestic question, we have to understand the extent to which Xi Jinping's repressive order is increasingly built upon his power. I want everybody in China to see the movie that was made some years ago called The Death of Stalin, because I think there's a lot to be learned there. Xi Jinping, as the poet said, no life lives forever. And at 68, even if he has 20 more years of active service, that too will pass. And I think there will be a definite reaction. Look at the reaction of the people in Shanghai and elsewhere to the current COVID policies that Xi Jinping has imposed on the country. That may have done more for promoting interest in human rights than a lot of the efforts many of us have engaged in over the years. Chinese people are now highly educated, highly critical. Look at the comments that are being made on the internet and the social media, et cetera. And of course, China's prominence in the world and various contacts stimulate the Chinese desire for a free life, as they say. So I think it's going to happen because I think socioeconomic progress pressures China's remarkable economic development itself generates the kinds of pressures against repression. And although the tools have been masterfully employed by Xi Jinping in terms of the security apparatus and propaganda, et cetera, to make people keep silent, they'll keep silent today, those who choose to stay in China, although some, of course, succeed in their efforts to leave. But it's not going to stay. Nothing stands still for long. And so there'll be change. And that change has got to be more enlightened, more liberal than the current repressive policy and the abuse of the legal system for repressive purposes. Now, in terms of the international situation, China is gradually taking over international institutions. It is cleverly using politics to wield in the various institutions of the United States, United Nations, and other international organizations considerable power. And of course, that's China's right in terms of the Chinese people are extraordinarily able, they're important, they're successful, and they have a right to have an influence on international affairs. They don't have a right to blatantly contradict the present order. Their failure to adhere to the Hong Kong agreement with the UK, their very blatant violation of their obligations under the law of the sea dispute resolution system, as they did in the outcome of the Philippines arbitration against China concerning the South China Sea. Those are examples of blatant disrespect for international law. And yet in many respects, China is not trying to overthrow the current system. It's trying to gain control over it. And it's making some progress. And of course, those of us who want to make sure that international law develops in a, you might say, creative, dynamic, favorable way, we have to be alert to what extent China's demands and actions warrant our agreement or our opposition. And we have to reach agreement on many of the questions that remain open now for negotiation. So I'm not so discouraged about the Chinese view of international law. If the Western powers can do more to get their act together, and sometimes they do surprisingly positive things, as they surprised Mr. Putin when he committed aggression against Ukraine recently. So a lot depends on the international community, and the Chinese government is necessarily reactive to how others behave. I think right now, China's losing a lot of goodwill in the world in various respects, some of them involving international law principles. Right now, their detention of foreign nationals who often were Chinese nationals and then adopted foreign nationalities, thorn in the relations with many countries. Australia, for example, is a prominent instance. So international law offers a mixed picture. There will be an ongoing struggle, and we have to not abandon it. On the other hand, we can't claim that God has put international law on our side in every dispute, and we have to be extremely careful in handling the Taiwan question.
Let me jump to now to Yacho Wang.
Hi, I'm Yacho Wang from Human Rights Watch. I grew up in the mainland. I came to the US for graduate school. So my identity is from a mainland Chinese person. And I feel that, you know, China is going to get more repressive. This is a given. So it's important for us who came from the mainland, who now live abroad, who live in democratic countries, to build a community that is pro-human rights, pro-democracy. But I feel in the past several years, there's a huge divide within the community, mainly not because of like we have different views towards Chinese politics, but because of the views on the US politics really divided us by generations, by, you know, how much you're integrated to the Western society. And that makes me feel very hopeless. It's not, of course, the Chinese politics make me hopeless, but the status of the diaspora community that is critical of the state of that community is also making me depressed. I mean, you know, Jerry, you've been helping this community for decades, and we're very grateful. And I feel it's very important that our community continue to thrive. What's your suggestions for us to, you know, for our community to go on?
Shakespeare said, "Physician, heal thyself." And the greatest crisis we confront, as you imply, is the terrible divisions within American society and our political system. And we have to do more to try to meet the current challenges, whether it be the forthcoming election or the next presidential election, and in the whole civic dispute. And it involves a great deal of public education. I'm depressed about the US situation. Of course, I'm depressed about the incidents where people of apparent Chinese descent have been abused in the United States. We have much to do. I'm not an isolationist. We have to continue to be active in the world, and we have to maintain our contacts, not only with China, but with other countries. But yet, our real struggle is at home. And I wish I could be more enthusiastic and optimistic about the possibilities of immediate remedy for the plight in which we find ourselves. And that inevitably has an impact on our international relations. Right now, I'm worried that in order to capture the American election for Congress coming up this year, the Biden people, very competent China specialists, may go too far in supporting Taiwan in a way that isn't good for Taiwan, and certainly isn't good for our relations with China. We shouldn't be making things worse. In other words, I'm in favor of doing more to show our support for Taiwan without, for example, putting our military forces on the island or making some formal defense commitment that would be a violation of the understanding we've had with the mainland since 72. So we have to move carefully. And we can't, because it might be attractive to winning more votes from a population in America that's very hostile to China now, take steps that would go too far in supporting Taiwan and might increase the dangers for Taiwan itself. So this is a complex situation.
Let me also take Yacho's question and try to ask it, there's another branch of that too, which is, there are a generation of Chinese students who are in the United States right now, who in many cases, young, not just students, but young people who are mainland Chinese, identify as mainland Chinese, but they are very depressed about things they see in their country. And I think I've heard a lot of people say, like, what, you know, what should I be doing? Like, what hope is there for me? And that's similar in the 1960s and 70s, you would have been interacting with Taiwanese students who were in the United States and were dealing with a dictatorship, a repressive state at home, and they were facing similar problems. Would there be words of advice that you gave to people in the 60s who were from Taiwan that you might not also now be giving to people who are young people or early 20s or 30s who are from the PRC about what they should be doing, what they should be thinking of for the future?
I would say take advantage of the time and opportunities they now have to improve their training, their professional equipment, their understanding of domestic and international affairs, and exchange ideas with their own group outside of China. And if they choose to go back to China, I hope they will learn more, but without themselves sacrificing their own lives and careers in what today would be a futile opposition. I just sent out a plea today for one of the human rights lawyers, the bravest of the group, Tang Jitian, who's been suffering for over a decade for his activities. I think we should try to help these people. People should not sacrifice themselves today because you have to wait and prepare for another day. I remember about 10 years ago, sitting in a coffee shop in Beijing with about a dozen human rights lawyers trying to discuss what's the proper position if they choose to stay in China. Should they try to go all out in opposition openly to the party's repression? Should they try to use the available, if limited, legal instruments to make repression more difficult, but operate within the existing rules and don't openly condemn the party, even though they know there'll never be progress unless the party surrenders its monopoly on power? I'm a practical person. There were some in that group, a minority, who thought they had to go all out in public. And I said, you won't be on the street in 6 months. You won't be worth anything to anybody. And that's what's happened, of course, to many of the best of them. And where the others have tried to operate within the system, but they've run afoul of that. I would urge the young people, get the best training they can and do what many Taiwanese did during the 60s and 70s. They acquired the equipment, the tools that they could then put to use once the political situation in their jurisdiction improved. So not everybody, of course, has listened to me. Although people always point out I was Ma Ying-jeou's professor, and I'm proud to say I am, and I'm still in close touch with his family. He has two wonderful daughters in the art field. But I also was advisor to Liu Xiaolian, and that Liu, who went to prison, sentenced for 12 years, and we worked to get her out with Ma's help after 5 years. She didn't listen to me. I urged her to stay away from Taiwan. And when she finished her master's degree at Harvard Law School, and she wanted to go back, take part in the political system, and they immediately clamped down on her within a year and a half of her return to Taiwan. So I don't think those who believe in human rights should become martyrs. But I think they should take advantage of the opportunity and operate within the limits of the existing system, whether they go back to the repressive area or stay abroad for a period of time. That will prepare them for the future. And this is not a novel problem. People in South Korea, of course, have gone through this, and some have chosen martyrdom. Others have, I think, wisely waited for another day. Kim Il-sung was always careful as a democratic opponent of the repression in South Korea that he didn't go to jail. He kept the things going on the outside, even though he had to trim his wings. Ultimately, he was vindicated and became president of a free Korea. That may be the best we can do at this time. Many people from Taiwan remained in Japan or the United States or Europe until the regime liberalized in the 90s. So I would say, get ready, establish yourself abroad if necessary. Don't forget what's going on in your country. Try to promote things there, but try to be on the street 10 years from now, or 20 years from now. I think of that wonderful woman, lawyer-trained journalist from Shanghai, who went to report on what was going on with the virus developing in Wuhan, and how they locked her up, and how she has really chosen martyrdom in Shanghai prison rather than making whatever concessions are necessary for her release so she'd be free to fight another day.
Great. Well, I've got four more people on the queue. I'm going to try to get all of them. I'll take you in pairs of two. So how about first Deanne and then Martin. Marty, I'll let the two of you ask your questions, and then Jerry can reply to both of you at the same time. And hopefully that'll give us enough time to do the last two.
Deanne Wilson from Resolutions LLC. And as you both know, I'm a retired Superior Court judge in New Jersey. So it's not far out for me to be very interested in the independence of the judiciary. And this was one of the first topics that I discussed with you, Jerry, about 15 years ago when you came to our judicial college. And it's my deep feeling that in any highly developed governance system that provides for the citizens, civil society to exercise their rights, an independent judiciary is essential, because if the legislative or the executive branches try to curb the individual's expression of their rights, there's no place where the individuals can go for redress or remedy. So I'm asking you, Professor, what has to take place within China? If China is to develop, as you have suggested, and I hope you're right, if China is to develop as a rule of law country, what, and I understand that depends on whose rule of law you think is the governing rule of law, but what has to take place in China in order to reestablish an independent judiciary, which started to develop there 8 to 10 years ago, and which Xi Jinping has quashed? What has to happen there to develop this independent judiciary?
Now, we'll also take Martin. Let's also take Marty as well, Martin Flaherty.
Great. Yes, thank you. Good seeing you, Carl, and good seeing you, Jerry. Martin Flaherty, School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton, and Fordham Law School, a colleague of Carl. Jerry, this is a question we've kicked around for decades, but what should legal professionals in the US, lawyers, law firms, legal academics, law schools do in the current situation to advance human rights and the rule of law and legal reform? And what should they avoid? And in particular, I'm thinking of the incidents that we discussed last week involving Davis Polk and Mayor Brown, as well as the position of US courts with regard to enforcing Chinese legal judgments and referring cases to China on forum non-convenience grounds.
Well, those are two pretty broad questions. With respect to the independence of the judiciary, there has to be a change in the dominant philosophy of the Chinese Communist Party. This involves the relation of the party to the government. This was being fought over in a preliminary way, at least, in the mid-80s in China. In those days, you had some enlightened Communist Party leaders who really thought that the party shouldn't dominate every government institution and decision, that the party should be limited to appointments, should be limited to policies, but should not really dominate day-to-day administration of justice or other matters. Unfortunately, those leaders did not survive the 1980s. And when Zhao Ziyang had to resign at the time that the June 4th situation was developing, the idea that the party should play only a limited role, that would have left the courts more independent. But with the current system, there's no hope for significant judicial independence, even though there are many good judges who in some cases do manage to make independent decisions. But on most matters of importance to the party and to the personal interests of many dominant political figures in China, judicial independence doesn't exist, and the party itself recognizes that it doesn't and shouldn't, it claims. So I think the key is the Communist Party going to exist, and will it change to some extent significantly if it does persist in power? With respect to the relation of party to government. I agree with Judge Wilson that there are powerful pressures that calling for recognition of more independent judicial decisions. The courts do not stand in good stead in popular opinion in China in most cases. But you also have to deal with the Chinese tradition. They don't come out of the English revolutions of the 17th century or the French and American revolutions of the 18th century. China has had a somewhat different evolution, but they can't ignore international influences, and that's why the party is always inveighing against them. The party fears foreign ideas, and that's why it's banning many fundamental ideas like constitutionalism and judicial independence. Martin's question is a very practical question that we confront. As American lawyers, what, if anything, can we do to encourage improvements in the administration of justice in China? Well, one thing lawyers have done in getting established in China is some have taken part in legal education there and giving lectures, holding programs, taking in trainees who are students or recent graduates. Law firms, of course, have seldom protested individual violations of human rights. Or taken political stands generally. And we're looking at how do law firms respond to the Russian situation today on foreign policy reasons. bar associations can do more. Martin and I have tried to mobilize various bar associations because individual law firms then don't suffer if protests come from the bar association. And if all the law firms involved with China or knowledgeable about China cooperate or at least maintain silence when the bar associations take positions. That's useful. We don't see enough of that. We continue to make efforts. We had a program just recently for the wonderful New York City Bar Association. Certainly law firms should not endorse repression. And this becomes difficult because you have to decide in what instances is their professional conduct so supportive of a repressive regime that it appears to be an endorsement of repression. Occasionally you get things that are blatantly stupid support for repression, as Martin mentioned, the recent profound criticism that the Davis-Polk firm gets for its apparent support for the national security regime now imposed on Hong Kong. Even the Mayor Brown law firm got involved with respect to the removal of the wonderful statue in favor of remembering the victims of June 4th at Hong Kong University. Sometimes there are close questions. Sanctions will make it increasingly difficult for firms to decide what to do. British law firms are increasingly giving up representation of various Russian economic and political interests. These are not simple matters, but I think individual law firms not only should be sensitive to not supporting repression, but ought to be doing more to oppose oppression. And there are individual lawyers in many firms who have been active, even though they can't get their firm to take a public stand. And sometimes law firms tell their lawyers, if you want to take a stand about human rights in China, you better go work elsewhere, because they regard themselves as technicians, as dentists. As I say, I admire the work of dentists, but I don't expect dentists to take some enlightened public position with respect to human rights and the rule of law. They're technicians.
I think we're going to have time. Unfortunately, we have to end at exactly 5:30. So I'm going to call on Cameron, and I think that might be all the last chance that we have.
Great. Thank you. This is Cam Carey, now at the Brookings Institution. Jerry, you may recall that when I was in the Obama administration as general counsel at the Commerce Department, I had the chance to lead a number of rule of law dialogues on commercial law, on anti-corruption and administrative transparency. And I see a little bit of a contradiction between your long-term optimism and sort of what you've described as sort of the continuity in approaches to rule of law and control since June 4. But you know, we've certainly seen, as you described, some expansion or steps towards expansion of the independence of the judiciary, other things. I recall meeting with the counterpart in one of the sort of high level dialogues that used to take place, not long after she took power, and being told, you're going to be surprised by how quickly we move on transparency and rulemaking and things like that. Well, I'm certainly surprised at how quickly they move, but in a very different direction than the anti-corruption, strengthen bribery laws, but it used them in very political ways. So I'm curious as to sort of looking at what you see as the institutional, the political, the legal schools of thought that sort of lay the foundations for the kinds of changes that you foresee down the road, and I think we all would love to see.
We're happy to respond quickly because we're going to have to end.
Is there a question? Really, what I said before, I think, summarizes my view. Once in a conversation with the PRC ambassador to the UN, Huang Hua, who later became foreign minister, a very able man, he didn't like an article I'd written in Foreign Affairs about the terms on which diplomatic relations could be established. This was 76. And he said the only sentence he agreed in that article was, I said, which one? Hopefully. He said, nothing stands still for long. And what we see looking back at the last 70 odd years of the party is things change. There will be pressures for change, and the pressures will affect the legal system. And I think we're at a low point now, but maybe I'm just an optimist. If I weren't an optimist, I never would have gone into Chinese studies, I suppose. My first boss when I came out of law school was Chief Justice Earl Warren. He'd been governor of California for 12 years before that, at the time of California's maximum economic growth. And he used to say, California wasn't built by pessimists. So I'm a believer in optimism. I'm a believer in trying. And I do think we have some basis for thinking there are forces for change in China, that if we can demonstrate in our own society that we can pull ourselves together and others in other countries can do the same, and if we keep up coupling with China in so many manifold ways, things will change.
That's just a perfect way to end. I'm with apologies to Susan Finder and Hugh Patrick. We can end directly on exactly on time. Thank you, Jerry, so much. I love that you can take the five decades and you summarize it and then sort of give us your vision, your optimistic vision going forward. So that's a great way to conclude. And thanks to Jerry, and thanks to all of you for attending. We'll look forward to having more roundtables like this at the Council on Foreign Relations. And please feel free to attend in person and virtually going forward. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Carl.